This is a bowl gouge. I own a Carter and Sons Toolworks bowl gouge. This bowl gouge, I believe, sells for $180 off the Carter and Sons Toolworks website. I bought this maybe a year ago now because I bought myself a chuck and I never knew it because I never really had much formal training, but you need a bowl gouge to turn bowls with. So of course I set out and I was like, I'm gonna buy the best bowl gouge that I can find online, and Carter and Sons was a decent option at the time. Now, like I said, up until maybe a year and a half ago, I had no formal training in wood turning. I didn't know much about it. All I knew is that you would use certain chisels to cut wood. And the first few bowls that I made, I used something called a roughing gouge. And if you look way, way back in my channel to the first few videos I made, you may see a video of me turning a bowl out of a branch using this same tool, I think, and it came out horrible. Now, I never knew it, and a lot of people don't, but you're not supposed to use roughing gouges on bowls. The reason being is they're just not made to handle that kind of cutting. Now, let's say I wanted to turn a bowl. I would grab a piece of wood like this, just a log cut in half with a chainsaw, and I'd cut it into a circle so it'd be easier to turn. Well, the grain orientation of this is going this way, so this is end grain and this is side grain. And when you turn it in a lathe like this, your chisel is going to be cutting end grain, then side grain, then end grain, then side grain, and end grain is a lot harder than side grain. So you're going to be cutting hard, then soft, then hard, then soft, then hard, then soft, and bowl gouges are made to handle that kind of stress that it puts on a tool. Roughing gouges, on the other hand, have been known to snap if you're turning them on a pretty big bowl. You might be able to get away with it on a smaller piece like I was doing a year and a half ago in that video, but if you're turning anything close to the size bowl that I made today, it's just gonna not be able to handle that kind of stress, and it may snap, the handle may break away from the tool, and the flute of it getting sucked up into the wood and thrown back at you, and that can lead to some serious problems or even death. So basically the main point here is, if you're turning a bowl, don't use a roughing gouge. It's not made for that kind of thing. I'm gonna re-explain that briefly. The reason why you should not use a roughing gouge for turning bowls is because the tang on it is too thin and short to handle that kind of hard soft alternation. The tang on a roughing gouge is shorter and thinner than a bowl gouge's tang. A bowl gouge's tang is actually called a rod because it's not just a square thin part of the metal that goes into the handle. The rod is thicker and round, and it goes deeper into the handle for more support. So that's why you should use a bowl gouge instead of a roughing gouge. So if you want to get yourself a bowl gouge, don't think you have to go out like I did and buy a Carter and Sons bowl gouge for $200. You can certainly just get a much cheaper one that will be good to start and learn on from Woodcraft or Craft Supplies or any sort of wood turning dealer near you. I would recommend the Robert Sorby tools because they are very good, high-quality tools for a very decent price. The bowl gouge people say to start with is a 5/8 inch bowl gouge. There are other sizes, like I think a 1/2 inch or a 3/8 inch. Get the 5/8 inch. They say that's the in-between kind of bowl gouge. Now, back to the point about the roughing gouge. A roughing gouge cannot do the types of things that a bowl gouge can do while cutting wood. A bowl gouge can do all sorts of different cuts, like push cuts and pull cuts and shear scraping and finishing cuts. It can act like a skew, a scraper, or a bowl gouge. A roughing gouge, on the other hand, you can only bring it head on into the wood and pull it either way, whereas a bowl gouge, you can hold it at different angles and carve different ways. Bowl gouges can also be used for spindle turning, so if you're a spindle turning kind of person, you might want to look into that. But then again, that makes the bowl gouge a much harder tool to learn how to use, but with practice, you will get good. And let me tell you, once you have mastered the bowl gouge, it is a very useful tool because you can do a lot of stuff with it. But what I'm going to be showing you guys to do today is how to turn a bowl, but mainly the technique that the bowl gouge uses to get into it. So let's go ahead and get started.
first cut you're going to want to learn with a bowl gouge is going to be your push cut. A push cut is basically you're going to be pushing the wood. And the way we do this is we ride the bevel. Now, most average Joes who don't know how to use a bowl gouge will put it like this with the flute turned up, and they'll just start cutting away, and that leaves a really ugly surface. Let me demonstrate. Well, this cut removes the wood very quickly and easily. It's impossible to keep a nice long push cut going. You're mainly just freehanding it, and the surface it leaves just has a ton of tear out. The correct way to make a push cut is with the flute turned 45 degrees either way at the very most. If you want to get a really clean, light cut, you'll have the flute facing completely vertically. And while this may look weird and seem like it's not going to cut very well, this will cut really, really clean. As you can see, that leaves a really nice surface on the wood. It kind of leaves kind of a satin glow to the wood, and it's very smooth. But like I say, that takes a very light cut, and if you want to get rid of the material quickly, you're going to be turning for a long, long time. So the way we can remove wood quickly but not have the flute facing up is, instead of having it face completely vertically like this, you can just tilt it a little bit and open it up, and that will allow you to take a heavier cut. Now, you never want to open it up more than 45 degrees, and any more than that, you're going to be ending up just freehanding the cut. The reason why we don't want to open it up more than 45 degrees is because our bowl gouge has a bevel. The bevel is just the angle here, the tip of it, you can say. And what we want to do is ride the bevel. So, how we do that is the bevel we're going to hold up parallel to the wood surface. Now, this can cause a lot of problems if you're doing it wrong. If it rubs into the wood surface and the blade isn't making much contact, then you're going to start bruising the wood. And you won't notice it at first, but over time, you'll get these odd marks going around your piece. And that's from the bevel rubbing into the wood too hard. So you want it to stay parallel, but the edge of your tool is going to want to be doing most of the action. So when you're working with your flute straight up like this, which you never want to do, you're not going to have a bevel to ride on. So you're always just going to be moving back and forth, and you cannot rely on that bevel to give you a really straight cut. You're going to just be eyeballing it, and that's never good. The piece will never look right. So when you ride the bevel, you can go straight across really easily without any problems, and it tends to give you a much cleaner surface as well. As you can see, that leaves me with a nearly flawless surface, and that will save you a lot of time when you're sanding this piece. Near the wings here, I'm getting quite a bit of tear out, and that's because I'm not turning solid wood like I am here. Almost over half of what I'm doing is turning air, and I'm only turning away wood when these come around, and that tends to chip out wood rather than cut it. Another trick you can use to get a really clean surface is instead of using your tool and cutting towards the bottom of the bowl, you should bring it towards the bottom of the bowl out. And this helps because you're cutting through side grain more, because the orientation of the grain in this is this way. So here you're going to have end grain, then you're going to have side grain, then end grain, then side grain. And the end grain is much harder than the side grain. So what this will do is, from turning hard, soft, hard, soft, hard, soft, what that'll do is the tool will be cutting away hardwood than softwood, and it'll give you a very ugly surface. So if we bring the tool this way, we'll be cutting through the side grain instead of dead onto the end grain, and that'll give you a much cleaner surface. Now, I should mention that if the end grain was the bottom of the bowl, like if the orientation of the grain was going this way, you'd want to do everything in reverse. You'd want to bring it from the top of the bowl down, because the grain orientation is different. And speed is always a concern while turning to get a clean surface. The faster your speed, the cleaner your surface will be. So on a piece like this, it might be kind of unstable. My lathe is weighted down quite a bit, so I can go really quick without having the lathe shake. But if your lathe starts to shake, you might be able to turn the speed up just a little past the point where it starts to jump a little, and that'll sort of balance it out and keep it steady. But if you're going to be turning at a slow speed, the surface you're going to get will never be this clean. My speed right now is at about 900 RPM, so I'm getting a nice clean cut. The next cut that'll be very helpful to know is something called a pull cut. Now, unlike a push cut where you're pushing in the direction of the wood, a pull cut is you're just going to be pulling. So how we're going to do this is keep the same rule of keeping the flute tilted no more than 45 degrees, but instead of riding the bevel, we're just going to pull it back, and it'll really help if you sort of sway your body to pull it back. We're going to want to sway our body back and keep the tool still while we're making pull cuts, because we won't have that bevel to ride anymore to give us a nice straight cut. So holding the tool steady, your whole body stiff, and just sort of rocking back, that will really give you as straight of a cut as you can ask for. But this pull cuts are not meant to be finished cuts. These are just meant to remove material quick. That surface is not as good as the one I did with my push cut, but it's still pretty close. So if you know what you're doing, you can get a pretty nice surface with this. Another thing to mention about the push cuts is if you start to feel like your tool is starting to grab and jerk down like this, then that's because your flute is turned up too high and the wood's wanting to push down on that bevel. So if that starts happening, just close off your tool a little bit more. You'll still get the same type of a cut. This surface is pretty clean right now, but we want to get it just even smoother, and for that we're going to be using a couple different types of cuts that'll really help smooth this out. The first one is a shear scraping cut. Now, a cool thing about the bowl gouge is you can use it as a lot of different tools. There's a theory in wood turning that they're all the same type of tool, they just look different, and I completely go for that because you can do a lot of different things with a bowl gouge. A nice, easy cut to make is something called a shear scraping cut, and it's where instead of cutting like this or like this, you use sort of this side, this piece right here, but you turn it completely closed off to the point where the top of it is just about to touch the wood, and that's how you scrape the surface. Let me demonstrate that. The part that I just scraped is really smooth now, and this is a super easy cut to do too. It's not that difficult. The only thing you want to worry about is not to turn the top of the tool, the part that's not doing the cutting. You don't want to turn that into the wood. When you start to get too close, it'll start to chatter, and that's when you know you need to open it up just a little bit. I'm just going to go ahead and do some shear scraping on this one side here. Now, of course, instead of using a bowl gouge, it might just be easier to use an actual scraper, but then again, this video is on stuff you can do with a bowl gouge, basic techniques and different types of cuts, and if I just told you to use a scraper, it might be a little strange. Now, when you're shear scraping, it gets a little tricky when you start to get around this point, because you end up with the bar of your tool almost completely parallel to the wood, and that's a little uncomfortable to turn like that. So another type of cut to smooth out this side of it is something called a finishing cut, and this is a little complicated, it's a little advanced. What it is basically a skew cut using a bowl gouge. How we do this is we choke up on the tool's handle a lot. We hold it almost completely up and down. Put it like this to the wood and just slowly turn the side of the blade right there into the wood and bring it across. So it's basically a skew cut with a bowl gouge. Again, that theory applies that they're all kind of the same tool. You can do the same thing. They just look different. So I'm going to set my tool rest at about center. And at this point, speed, you're going to want to turn it up as fast as you can go without the lathe jumping and rocking. And the reason being is the faster your speed, your cut will be a lot cleaner. So here we go. the surface you will get off a cut like that is absolutely priceless. You cannot do this with a lot of other tools. But the only downside to this type of a cut is it requires a lot of skill and technique to pull it off. So if you're a beginning turner, I would just stick to shear scraping or just using an actual scraper for this. Because a cut like that, it's kind of scary to do. Your tool, if you're not doing it right, it can slide back from you. But the cut quality is just priceless. Shavings that come off a cut like that are so fine.
Okay, we're almost done with the bowl, but at this point my tool usually starts getting a little dull. I don't know what quality steel your bowl gouge will be, so yours might get dull a lot quicker, but it's usually when I finish shaping the outside and I'm ready to start on the inside of the bowl. That's when I will sharpen up my gouge. The flute of my gouge comes out, and this is nice because of two reasons. One, when you grind it down so much so it's just a little stub, you can go to the store and buy a new flute to replace it. Two, it makes it a lot easier to sharpen because when you're trying to sharpen a gouge this long, it gets kind of tricky. To sharpen my bowl gouge, I use the Rikon 8-inch slow speed bench grinder with a 120 grit wheel and an 80 grit wheel. And I usually use the 120 grit just for touching up something to put on a nice edge. The 80 grit wheel I don't recommend to start sharpening stuff because it more just grinds away material than put on a nice sharp edge. I have the Wolverine grinding jig from One Way attached to the base of my grinder, and this is for turning tools, and the point of this is to give you the same grind every time so that it won't be different and you have to relearn how to use your tool. For sharpening my gouges, I use a One-Way Verigrind jig, although you can also use a David Ellsworth jig, and I think Captain Eddie Castlin sells a Blackhawk jig, which he makes them, so you might want to look into that if you're considering one. Very important thing to mention, when you have this in your Verigrind jig, if this is the jig you have, the angle between this little arm and the flute of your gouge has got to be 23 degrees, so take a protractor and trace it on a piece of paper and try to line it up as best you can. The reason it has to be 23 degrees is if it's not, which I have had experience with this, mine was never set to that, and I didn't know no better, but what will happen is from grinding away constantly without the 23 degree angle, the wings on your bowl gouge will come way back and it will not be the right grind and it will be extremely difficult to use. So make sure that's at 23 degrees. I have a block here that I drilled a 5/8 inch hole in, 2 inches down. The reason I have this is because the tip of your tool should always be 5 inches from your jig. So I just place it in there. Once it bottoms out, I just tighten down this knob and we're ready to go. Now we're going to need to set the base of this. So you put the arm here just in there and you want to line up the angle to this. Now I already have mine lined up from the last time I sharpened my bowl gouge, but if you're lining it up, you're just going to loosen up the knob and move this back and forth. And there are some things called, the brand is Raptor, I think, I don't know what they're called, but it's an arm with different angles set to pull this back different lengths at a time for specific grinds on tools, and that will give you a much more consistent cut than just lining it up by eye. And if you're not that good at lining things up by eye, you can just take a Sharpie and just scribble on the edge of your tool just to give you a line, and you can put the tool in there. just spin the wheel on it.
And you should see where the line, or where the stone cut away at the metal. And if it's straight across, it's lined up perfectly, but if it's only like halfway there, you need to adjust it a little more.
So put on your safety glasses, and we can get growing. Just gonna touch it down. You don't want to put a lot of pressure on the tip because it'll grind away too much. I'm just gonna roll it. Make sure it went all the way to the edge, and then you just touch it up a little bit. That's all there is to it. I can take this out of my jig and I'll put it back in the handle. Turning the inside of a bowl is actually, in my opinion, a lot easier and quicker than the outside. Since this is going to be a natural edge, I'm going to pull up my tailstock just for a little bit of added support. Okay. Now for right now, I'm just going to take some really light push cuts just in, and I'm going to leave the wall thickness thick because this wood is a little green and it still has to dry out the rest of the way. But there's not much technique into this part yet. It's just going to be kind of the same thing as a push cut, except I'm going to go straight in instead of just try to move across. So again, I'm just going to go straight in this way. Once it bites, I'm just gonna sort of swing it out like that. So, like that, and then bring it in. So, just like that.
So basically, that whole swinging motion of just pushing in and swinging it into the center, that can be done a lot easier when you have your tailstock out of the way. But I don't want to bring my tailstock out of the way because this is kind of still heavy and it's not going to be supported very well if I bring the tailstock out. And when you start to not be able to really swing too much because you're getting too deep and the tailstock is in your way, I just did a pull cut. And basically it's the same thing in reverse. I'm just going to bring it in. Once it starts to cut, I'm just going to swing out just in the opposite direction. I just pulled the tailstock out because it's getting really hard to get in there now. And one thing is, your hand's going to be way back to this side of the lathe. And when you start pushing in like that, your elbow can sometimes hit your live center. So just take your whole live center out so you won't get poked. Just bring up this. And I'm just going to clean it up in the center there. Your tool to be hanging off over the edge too much, so just move your tailstock in every now and then. Okay, now that I'm getting close, I want to make sure that my wall thickness is nice and even. So I have a set of calipers here, and I'm going to set it to the lip. And I need to take away more towards the bottom. A lot more. Could tell how much by setting it, so I still have about that much wall thickness towards the very bottom. And I probably still have maybe an inch and a half to take away towards the bottom. So just keep on going until your wall thickness is even. Shavings will really get packed in there. It's kind of annoying. Thank you. gonna go with even for right now. I think it's about even. Now, as far as scraping with a bowl gouge goes, I suppose you can use a shear scraping cut and just run it along the wall. But I don't really like doing that on the inside of a bowl, so I always use just a round nose or a French scraper, these are sometimes called. This is for bowls. Something this deep, I would not just use something like a regular round nose scraper, because the tang is oftentimes not long enough and you don't have enough handle to support that. So you want a nice, long, strong handle. We'll set the tail torus to a little above center. At this point, if you were just going to finish turning this whole thing in one shot, you'd move on to sanding, but I'm not going to do that because this is green, so it's just rough turned. So I can just take it out of my chuck. At the foot, I'll just write the date today. It is June 12th, 2015. This wood is maple. And I can go ahead and put this in a bag filled with shavings. I have a ripped off piece of paper here, and I just weighed it on my scale, and it came out as 1420.7 grams. So I'm gonna put this in here, and every now and then, I think I go maybe every month, I'll take all my bowls that I've rough turned out and set them on the table and let them air overnight so they don't mold up in the bag. And I'll weigh them and I'll write down the weight, and once they start losing weight, that means all the moisture has left the wood and it's dry, so you can finish turning it. And that'll sit there for a while now while it dries out with all the other bowls. And once it's stopped losing weight and all the moisture, or most of it at least, is gone from the wood, you can put it back on the lathe and finish turning it. Okay, well, I hope that was helpful to a lot of you guys or beginning wood turners who are trying to learn how to use a bowl gouge or just to turn a bowl. If you can't do some of the cuts that I showed in this video, don't worry, just keep on practicing. I wouldn't practice on any nice pieces of wood. I would just grab some really soft wood, maybe pine, just cheap garbage wood, and practice, 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 because you will get better. I will have a new video up next Friday, so if you're interested, please subscribe and check back then. As always, thank you for watching. My God, there's so many shavings.